Hi, I'm Steve King.
And I'm Johnnie Putman.
And today we're coming to you from the Advanced Technology Center at Gulf Coast State College in Panama City, Florida. When we've been hanging out, doing a little bit of teaching and some radio drive-bys, so that is why, unfortunately, we can't be back at the WGN studios for this year's Walk of Fame induction ceremony.
We know the Walk of Fame induction ceremony is a very big deal. In fact, it's a big deal to see your name in bronze right there on Michigan Avenue. So congratulations to the inductees. I'll never forget our day just 2 years ago. And this is really something special. And I'm sorry we can't be there to be with you, because many of these inductees are not only colleagues, but they're good friends too.
And we've shared a lot of interesting times, some of which we will tell you about and some of which we may skip over. But let's start
They'll be
with,
in the book.
Yeah, they will be in the book. Let's start with Nick DiGilio. We have been hanging out with Nick really since just about the first time that we started at WGN Radio. Nick had been doing some work with Roy Leonard, and we liked what Nick was doing and asked him if he wouldn't mind coming in and hanging out with us every once in a while and reviewing some movies. And he, fortunately for us, said yes.
He did that. It was on the Sunday night, Monday morning show, and that's when we would start at 2 o'clock in the morning. And Nick would come in at the beginning of the month and he would give us a rundown of movies that were going to be coming up that month. Well, it had become pretty obvious to us from listening to him on Roy's show that his passion was, in fact, movies.
You think?
Yep. And wacky movies. Movies that Roy didn't like to go see and movies that we found out we didn't like to go see either. But the fun thing was his knowledge of movies. That was the exciting thing. Was he really, really had a love for movies. And we saw early on, I mean, he was just a teenager, that he had a love for radio too. And he was good.
Well, and at the time that we were first talking with Nick, not only was he displaying his love for radio and talking very articulately about movies, he was also directing plays and acting in some plays. So we knew that this was a multi-talented guy that we wanted to give the opportunity to expose himself to, if that's the right word. Yeah, with Nick, maybe we shouldn't say it that way. But we enjoyed having Nick on. In fact, we wound up, unfortunately, I don't think Nick knows this, but we wound up having to go to bat for Nick a couple times with a particular program director who said, "Why are you having this guy on the radio?" And we said, "Because he's good. And besides that, you're not paying him. We are." So we were able to continue to have Nick on.
And we're happy about that, too, because that's a long time and a lot of radio shows that we did with Nick. And then Steve had a period where he was ill for 5 months. We were off the radio, and we knew our show was in good hands because Nick, with his then partner, Gary Lee Wright, filled in for us for those 5 months. They held down the fort. They did what we like to do every night, and that was come in there and just bring the news of the day and give people an opportunity to talk about it. And we would listen from home. And as I said, we knew our show was in good hands.
And we had a lot of interesting times with Nick. Do you remember the time that we almost burned down the radio station?
I do. It was Nick's 40th birthday. And we always had a birthday party on the show. It was an excuse for cake.
Sure.
More on that in a little bit. We decided that we would have Nick's dad come down to the radio station, and he would bring the White Castles, which would be our meal, since that was a favorite, and a cake. I decided, since Nick hated The Lion King, that would be the theme of our party.
Of course.
The Lion King. So we had the Lion King cake, and we had the hats, and we had the balloons, and the decorations, and he walked in, and it was like, and Nick's own way. The eyes roll. You could practically hear them rolling.
Now, what we should explain, for those of you that have never seen it, that WGN studio had a hidden door, kind of like if you see these panels here. It was actually a false panel, and behind that panel was another room, and that's where we hid Nick's father.
But Nick's dad got excited. He was a little anxious. And he lit all 40 candles in a room that's basically a large closet. Well, there's also a smoke detector in that room. Next thing you know, little did we know, the candles had been lit. Security is in the studio. They're all over us, which added some excitement to the party. And then we had his dad come out. The candles were melting on top of the cake. He then realized that he had set off the alarm, the silent alarm, which brought security. And then we had cake and White Castles and had a great time. And it was just one of those memorable nights.
And it's one of many memorable nights that we were privileged to share with Nick. And Nick is just carrying on the tradition of great all-night radio on WGN. And boy, is his induction to the Walk of Fame at WGN long overdue. Speaking of long overdue, there are some people that when you mention their names, they're associated with WGN. Larry Schreiner was one of those people.
Absolutely. I had the good fortune of working with Larry not only on our all-night show, but for 7 years that I was doing traffic on the morning show with Bob Collins. Larry was my right-hand man. I would know because we would have finished up the all-night show if there was a story that Larry was going to be covering. He was in his element after dark. He was absolutely the vampire.
In fact, the operating instructions that all of our producers had, regardless of who the guest was, what we were into, if Larry Schreiner calls, he goes on now. Because we knew whatever Larry would call about in the middle of the night, that was going to be the headline story for the next morning. And Larry was a news junkie, is a good way to describe it. Larry would drive around in his car, and in the back of his car, now this is going back to the Stone Age, before digital technology, Larry had VCRs set up in the back of his car. So if he goes to an accident, a crime scene, whatever, he takes the footage, he reports to us, and then he's developing copies of the footage that he just took and delivering it around to all of the radio stations in the Chicago area.
Television
stations.
Sure.
And at that point, he was really the only guy that was doing this, and he was so far ahead of his time.
Absolutely. In fact, when you turned on morning television news, there was a good chance you were going to see some footage of Larry Schreiner's, because he was out there working the streets tirelessly. And as you said, if he called, no matter what was going on, because we knew he was all business, it had to be serious, and we had to go with it. And Larry had his own style. I mean, he developed Schreinerisms. He mangled the English language to the point where it became something you look forward to.
It was very heinous.
It was heinous, yes. And when I would hear him say something like it was heinous, and Bob's eyes would just, what did he just say?
Bob Collins, of course.
Bob adored him too, because he brought something to the show. When he did that crime report after 6 o'clock in the morning, you knew that radios were going on because they wanted to hear what was the crime, what had happened overnight. It was basically a synopsis, just cold hard facts, ma'am. I'll never forget when I finally said to him, Larry, I've known you for 15 years. Please stop calling me ma'am.
And he never would.
He never would, no.
And do you remember the night we had Larry on one night? Because he had a multifaceted personality and he was fun to talk to. One night we had Larry on one of our Saturday evening shows as the love counselor. That was a night that will live in infamy, I believe, in the annals of Chicago broadcasting.
Partly because we had not talked to Larry like that. He was interested in getting a date, and he was interested in sharing what he thought made a good date. And it was fun radio. It was a side of him that we had not experienced, because it was the playful Larry. It was the Larry before the sun went down.
We should also mention that if you had Larry Schreiner for a friend, you had a friend. Back in the early 90s, when I had a very bad accident over in London and was on crutches when we flew back, meeting the plane when we came back into O'Hare was Larry Schreiner. Larry had arranged so we wouldn't have to go through customs or anything. People came on the plane, they met us, and Larry stayed with us and made sure that we got back home safely. Larry was a one-of-a-kind friend.
Remember how we got back home, too. we were actually escorted on the Kennedy Expressway so that everybody get out of the way. This is precious cargo. We've got to get him home. He's had a nightmarish experience. And you didn't have to ask him to do something like that for you. He just naturally did it because, as you said, he was a friend. You knew that Larry was in the house because there would be donuts.
Yep.
And we learned a great thing from Larry. If you're going to go to a hospital for any reason whatsoever, take donuts to those hardworking people. Those nurses, they go above and beyond. Take them some donuts. And we learned that. And that's something that I think was part of his legacy, that he would show respect for you. He knew that if you worked hard, and he wanted you to realize that you were being appreciated. And, you know, that's a special person, a neat guy who seems so hardcore and all business and, oh, I don't care about the English language. I just got to get the facts out, ma'am. That's the kind of guy he was, but there was a really soft center to him, too.
Well, speaking of driving back to the radio station, we have to segue into traffic and Mike Mathis.
Well, when I started at WGN Radio, I was hired to take over the traffic department. Up until that time, I mean, the radio station was known for traffic coverage, but nothing had ever come from in-house. Everything was always on the streets from the helicopter. So you had a couple of guys, a Chicago police officer and a state policeman who were out there doing the job. I was brought in to gather the facts. So in the event the weather prohibited them from going out, something would come out of the traffic department. So Mike was there to greet me when I was hired. And it was a very big deal because he'd been doing traffic for some time, and now here's this person coming in to tell us how it's done. And he was wonderful. We became great friends because doing the job that we did in the morning on the Bob Collins Show, we covered some of the biggest stories. He were the eyes in the sky. I'm on the phone. While I'm talking to Bob, I'm working the story, trying to get the facts, trying to get the leads so Mike could go out and get to the bottom of it. And that was the relationship I had with Larry Schreiner, too. Behind the scenes, we were working tirelessly with scanner radios and phone calls, old school, to get a story and to get it right and to get it on the air.
In fact, let me segue back to Larry for 1 second.
Yeah.
Would you tell the story about the morning that you're up in Traffic Central with Bob? And Larry Schreiner was the world's best dad, too. But he didn't want this particular morning, he didn't want to worry his kids with where he was and what he was doing. You want to explain that?
Well, his twin boys would usually have to be rousted out of bed while Larry was on the streets covering a story. So it was my job to call them to be sure that they were up and getting dressed for school. And on this particular morning, Larry was at a hostage situation and he was lying on his belly in a gutter, half exposed. He was under a car, but his whole body wasn't under the car for protection. And it was a, this hostage situation. The guy was armed. So there was some real concern that he was going to get angry at the people who were out there. And Larry on the two-way radio says, Johnnie, call my boys. Make sure that they're up. And ma'am, don't tell them where I am. Okay, Larry, fine. But that was him. And he was a great dad. He really was. And he worked really well. I mean, the combination of Mike Mathis in the sky and Larry on the street and me behind the scenes, it made our job so exciting because Bob Collins would say to us, today, you guys are the story. It's your radio show. If it was a snowstorm, if it was a rainstorm, if it was a traffic accident, a hostage situation, Bob would just basically turn it over to us and say, you know, whatever you need, it's your time. And that was just a wonderful experience.
But then there was a time when Johnnie, rather than doing traffic, was going to do all of the show overnight with me. Bob Collins was not a happy camper about that. But that also meant that there needed to be a new person coming in to Traffic Central to handle morning drive traffic with Bob Collins. And that's when you brought Ann Maxfield over.
That's right. I had worked with Ann Maxfield to the extent that we would share information because she was doing traffic down the street. So if I had a lead on a story, I might call her and ask her if she had anything and we would share information. So I knew that she was the best and she might be interested in leaving that radio station down the street. So when I broke the news to Bob that I wanted to go all nights with you instead of working half the shift with you and then the morning show with him.
And Bob did a lot of harumph, harumph, harumph,
harumph. Yes, he did. But he realized that it was a big opportunity for me to be able to spend the whole evening with you. And frankly, I was a little tired after doing both shifts. And I said, you know, maybe you should talk to Ann Maxfield. And Ann Maxfield came over, I'll never forget. We all went out to have a bite to eat together. And he got to know her, and she became Annie. And was just
and as Spike used to call her, and Max Fern.
Max Fern, yes. She was just a wonderful, wonderful part of the morning show, and then went to the afternoons and was Spike's right-hand person. And I'm just tickled that she's being acknowledged and recognized for her time spent at WGN.
And we have to mention Judy Pilak,
yes,
and Jack Rosenberg, and all the people that are being inducted this year. Again, we're so sorry that we're not able to be there. We are going to be coming back in a couple weeks, and we're going to be doing some appearances around the Midwest, so we hope to see you at some point. But we just wanted to take a second to not miss out on this really important 2017 induction for the WGN Walk of Fame.
So congratulations.